Well, at the risk of starting with our honored guest, I would like to stay in the schedule so we can have dinner this evening. So I think I'll take it upon myself to open this second session. Have a presentation by Alex Bell. And Alex is going to talk about application transient response methods to study the mechanism and dynamics of catalyzed reactions.
Well, let me begin by thanking the organizers for this opportunity to come here and celebrate the career and work of Sheldon Gaur. Now, although I'm of an age where I could have been one of Michelle's academic children, in fact, one of his first academic children, if I look at the time when I went into graduate school, I'm not, nor am I his academic grandchild or any other blood relation. But nevertheless, over the last 25 years that I've known Michelle and have been reading his work and studying from his books, I've developed a great appreciation for his contributions to catalysis, and most of all, for his contributions to the kinetics that attend catalysis. And his emphasis that catalysis really is about reaction rates and therefore about kinetics. And that if we want to know something about the details, we have to look at the catalyst under working conditions and use spectroscopy in situ. So in that spirit, I've chosen the theme for this presentation to talk about transient response techniques, and as you'll see, we'll also touch upon in situ spectroscopy. So by way of introduction, let me start here by noting that one of the long-range objectives in the field of catalysis is to learn how reactions proceed from reactants to products. So this means that we want to determine the reaction pathway. That can be done by using various techniques to piece together, or piece out, actually, the various elementary steps that occur. And for each of these elementary steps, we'd like to know what are the rate parameters. So we can then reassemble this information into a molten rate. And we've already seen some illustrations of that in previous talks. Such mechanistic studies can also help identify the relationships between the structure of the catalyst and what makes the catalyst work. At what point is the activity of the catalyst dictated by a particular catalytic step? And at what point is the selectivity dictated? Now, a lot of what we learn about mechanism and kinetics can be gotten out of steady state analyses of rates. But if we want to go even deeper, we have to use transient response techniques. So let me move to the next transparency and give you a little bit of an introduction as to what we mean by transient response techniques. In a transient response experiment, one has a stimulus, which is imposed by the experimenter, and the catalyst and reaction system gives a response. And here are three examples. Isothermal reactor and impose concentration modulation, usually very small, so that we won't at the same time swing the temperature of the reactor, and then look at the response and interpret that response to get out the details of the kinetics. We might operate under steady state conditions and work with an isotopically labeled reactant called R star in this case. And then at some time, zero over here, move from the blue to the green, the unlabeled reactant, keeping the concentration the same, and look at the response in terms of the decay in the labeled product. And from this, again, one can deduce the kinetics, and in fact, from the area under this curve, one also can deduce the holdup of the labeled species on the surface. Then the last example would be kind of a combination of things, where one might first, at a constant temperature, introduce a reactant or a set of reactants, and turn off that flow in a very sharp fashion, and then programmatically raise the temperature in a linear fashion, and watch then which products come out. And in this case, we have a typical temperature program desorption or temperature program reaction spectrum. Now, what I'm going to show you in the balance of the talk is how we use these two techniques to get information about the reactions of carbon monoxide and hydrogen, and in the final example, carbon monoxide and CO2. Hydrogen and CO2. So just a word about how one interprets a transient response experiment. One has to assume a mechanism. For example, let's say we have the unimolecular transformation of A to product P over here, a very simple mechanism. And we did an experiment in which we introduced a label A, and then we looked at the decay in the product containing label A, and we introduced unlabeled A over here. We can carry out an analysis in this very simple case where there's only one intermediate and conclude that the decay in the labeled species over here should go as an exponential characterized by a rate coefficient K2 going through this step over here. And if we fit the exponential to this decay, we can determine K2. And then if we measure the initial rate here, then we can determine coverage of the species that is giving rise to the product. Now, what I'm going to show for you are three illustrations in three different ways of using transient response techniques. The first is concerning the formation of methane from CO and hydrogen. And here we'll look at how one can deduce what is called the distribution function of reactivity coefficients, and we'll see that we can identify two forms of carbon that are rise to methane. Then we'll talk about a more complex system that produces a whole spectrum of hydrocarbons, Fischer-Tropsch synthesis. And we'll conclude with a brief examination of methanol decomposition and synthesis over copper catalyst, where we use the technique both in a qualitative and in a quantitative way to define the reaction mechanism. Now, in the formation of methane, work by a number of authors suggests that what happens is that CO adsorbs as a molecule and then dissociates irreversibly to produce basic carbon and oxygen. This oxygen goes off as water. And then through a sequence of steps, this carbon picks up hydrogen and eventually produces methane. And a part of these CHX species can be diverted into a pool known as C beta, which accumulates on the catalyst. These are hydrocarbon-like species which accumulate on the catalyst and eventually give rise to the poisoning of that catalyst by blockage of sites. So what we would like to know is how rapidly are these species over here converted to methane versus this carbon over here. And what one can do is a transient response experiment in which one switches from some routine labeled CO, deuterium rather than hydrogen is just for convenience in terms of looking at the cracking patterns in the mass spectrometer products, and then you switch to an unlabeled feed that has the C12 labeled CO in it, and you monitor the concentration of C13 labeled methane as a function of time. Now, for the analysis, we're going to use a very simple kinetic scheme that assumes that going from here to here and from here to there occurs by a parallel mechanism, but that not all the carbons in each of these pools are equivalent. So to remind you what the experiment is, here's just a schematic of it, showing you that initially we started with the 13 labeled carbon dioxide, hydrogen or deuterium, and switched to the unlabeled feed, same gas composition, so the reaction remains at steady state, and then we follow the decay time. Now if we had a very simple system, this decay would be purely exponential, as I showed you in the earlier example. So let's take a look now at what one sees in fact in the experiment. And to make things evident, I've plotted the results here for the normalized rate of formation of C13 labeled methane produced over the thulium on silica catalyst as a function of time. And plotted this on semi-logarithmic coordinates so that if this were a simple exponential, we would have seen a straight line looking something like this. Now, in fact, you see not a straight line, but a curve, which means that the kinetics are much more complex. complex or that we have more than one type of carbon. So one way to analyze this problem is to assume that we have various pools of carbon, each with its own reactivity, and that for each pool of carbon, there is an apparent rate coefficient, call it K apparent over here, and that the rate of methane formation is proportional to that K apparent and the coverage in carbon. And so for each type of carbon and each reactivity of carbon, there's a particular value of K sub A P. So if I want to know then the time decay of this coverage, I have to write this first order differential equation and solve it. And I see that for each kind of carbon and each reactivity of carbon, there's an exponential decay. To get the overall rate of methane formation of the label that I observe experimentally, I need to integrate over the various kinds of reactivity. And in order to do this, I need to know the distribution function of reactivities. And that's given by this function f of k, which is the first order apparent rate coefficient for conversion of carbon to methane. And this then is weighted against this exponential. Now, this is what I can measure, and what I want is this function. Now, if you look at the structure of this equation, you see that it is in the form of a Laplace transform. And in the literature, there are now a number of ways of taking the inverse Laplace transform of this function to discover this distribution function, and this can all be done numerically. I don't want to dwell on the way in which we do this, just show you the results of the analysis. What the analysis produces for us is a plot of f of k versus k, so the distribution function is a function of the rate coefficient. And you'll notice that it is bimodal. There's a peak here at low values of k, a peak here at high values of k. In fact, we can manipulate the relative weights of these two peaks by the duration in which we run this catalyst in C13 labeled methane, and by this means discover that the peak associated with the larger values of K, or first order rate coefficient here, are associated with alpha carbon, and the peak with the lower values of K are associated with the beta carbon. Once we know that, we can in fact integrate under these individual peaks and find out the proportions of the two kinds of carbon. So what we learn from this experiment then is that not only are there two kinds of carbon, but each of these has a distribution of reactivities, and that can be seen by the fact that these functions are not sharp delta functions, but rather broad distribution functions. And the average values here of k are separated by about an order of magnitude. So that's the message from the first part of this story. Again, I emphasize that here, show that the analysis of transient response curves obtained from these isotopic tracers can be used to obtain the distribution of first order rate coefficients. This shows a bimodal distribution, which can be identified with the alpha and beta forms, and each one is characterized by a spectrum of first order rate coefficients. So there's not a unique value associated with carbon. Now what I'd like to do next is move on to the second example, which is the most complex of the three, and talk about the formation of hydrocarbons and what we can learn about the dynamics of hydrocarbon formation under Fischer-Tropsch conditions. Now if you look at the top part of the mechanism for forming hydrocarbons during Fischer-Tropsch, you'll recognize that it's very similar to that for forming methane. I showed you earlier. CO adsorption in a molecular form, dissociation produces an acyl carbon, stepwise hydrogenation to form a high methylene and methyl species. That can terminate, methyl can terminate methane, or it can react with a methylene unit and thereby initiate a polymerization, make higher and higher homologs. And a chain termination of the chain growth process occurs either by the addition of a hydrogen atom, which is an alkane, or removal of a hydrogen atom, the corresponding polar. Now, a lot of work has been done in this area, in Japan, in the US, and in Europe. And what it it's shown is that these olefins, once produced, if present in sufficient concentration, will reabsorb and re-enter the chemical pathway here. So for example, ethylene can reabsorb to produce this ethyl group here. That can depolymerize to produce additional methylene units, which are the building blocks of ethyl units. The same can happen with the higher homologs, the olefins here, higher molecular weight olefins, except the process is efficient. Now what we'd like to do is identify, in fact, what are these rate coefficients here, KI, KIR, termination rate coefficient, propagation rate coefficient, and these others that are identified on this transparency. So that's the objective, and the way that we proceed to do that is, again, to carry out an isotopic response experiment. And again, the experiment involves a switch, this time from unlabeled to labeled, for reasons of experimental convenience. We follow the composition of the products by gas chromatography mass spectrometry. And from this analysis, we can calculate a function called f of n, which is time dependent, which represents the fraction of C13 labeled product containing n carbon atoms. So for each n product containing n carbon atoms, there will be a separate response. So we'll look at these in just a moment from the experiments. Now what we'll do is look at how we simulate these responses in order to then deduce what these rate coefficients are. So let's look at the experiments first. Here is a typical response after the switch from C12 to C13 labeled CO. Notice it occurs over about a 2 minute time span. And here are the responses for C2, 3, and 4 hydrocarbons. There's not much of a spread. There's a small spread, but it needs to be blown up in order to see it. And down here we have the responses for C5 through C8. As we go to the higher and higher hydrocarbons, higher and higher molecular weights, we can see more and more of a delay in the response, which is what you would expect if you were looking at a polymerization network where you inject a tracer into the monomer pool, and now you look at the products coming off the surface of the catalyst. The longer the chain, the longer it'll take to build up the label in the products. So now what we do is we go through a simulation of these data. And that's done using the structure I show you on the next transparency. So here's a schematic of the reaction network recast as a set of pools or boxes. Think of each box as a reservoir of a given type of species. So over here we have the CH2 units, the monomer, over here the methyl group, over here the propyl, here the pentyl. The lines between indicate the passage of material from one box to another. So for example, along this line, we're adding a methylene unit to grow the chain. The reverse direction would be depolymerization. Termination at any point occurs over here. And in order to properly simulate the dynamics that we see experimentally, we have to include a very small but not negligible pool of fissy-sorbed material. This pool becomes more and more important as we go out higher and higher in molecular weight, starting at about C6. Less than C6, these pools are negligibly small. Now, one can characterize this network in terms of a series of time constants, and the time constants, in turn, are related to rate coefficients for elementary processes and appropriate coverages. I show these here. The point is just to count how many time constants dominate the system. So there's one here for the monomer, one for the methyl groups, one for the ethyl groups. And then from there on in, everything is the same because it turns out that this is a very small number. So this is essentially a constant. So we're up to four time constants. And then there is a fifth, which is characterizing the holdup in these fissy-sorbed pools, But it turns out that the lead term, again, is small, and the remaining term, which is associated with the flushing out of the system, can be calculated from first principles. So it's not a constant that is adjustable, but it's calculable a priori. So in effect, we have four time constants dominating the system. And then we have the probability of chain growth over here, which in fact is just one constant that can be deduced from the steady state analysis of the steady state product distribution. Well, how do we get the rate coefficients out of all of this? What we do is we write a set of differential equations, first order ordinary differential equations, which are nested, and that's what makes it a little bit complex, for each of the species. So each of these f functions is governed by an appropriate differential equation. And because these are linear equations, we can solve them by Laplace transform techniques. And we can then proceed to fit the solution to the experiment so that we can deduce the time constants. Once we have the time constants and the steady state results from this, we can piece out rate coefficients. So let me just pass from here directly to the results to show you how much one can squeeze out from this kind of analysis. So here are the rate coefficients for propagation, termination, and initiation of the chain, and I note that they are independent of the space velocity through the catalyst bed. And we have also shown that they're independent of the carbon. And for the top two, we have been able to determine the apparent activation energy, 8 kilocalories for propagation, 20 kilocalories for termination. On the bottom, I show you the calculated surface coverages by various intermediates. It's about 20% of a monolayer of the monomer, and much smaller quantities than of the growing chains. And we can ask whether these are just numbers which you deduce by fitting the equations to the data, or do they bear any physical meaning? And one way to do that is to summarize all the carbon held up in this inventory and compare that with a temperature program reduction of the catalyst after reaction. And when one does that, one finds that there is excellent agreement between the number you get out of the calculation here and that which you get from experiment. I can push this all one step further. This is the last thing I want to show you in a second. To look at this part of the network here at the front end, where you have some reverse processes occurring here, here, here. And one can also deduce the rate coefficients for these processes, which I show you here. Looking at these numbers doesn't have much meaning, but if we take the product of the rate coefficient times the holdup in one of these pools, we can look at the rate or the velocity along each one of these lines. And it's interesting to look at pairs of lines which are related and see whether we are close to equilibrium. So for example, the formation of methyl groups for methylene in the forward direction, 1 times 3 minus 2, in the reverse direction, half of that roughly. Formation of ethyl groups, and the reverse would be a kind of depolymerization, very close to being at equilibrium. And likewise, the adsorption and desorption of methylene, this pair of reactions. Again, these are close to being at equilibrium. So there's quite a bit of detail that one can squeeze out from this set of experiments that I've shown. So just to conclude the segment, the rate coefficients for elementary processes occurring during Fischer-Tropsch synthesis can be determined, in fact, from transient response tracer experiments. It requires that we take into account the fissorbed material. Ethylene reincorporation into the chain growth process is particularly rapid and leads to the formation of new CH2 groups that are formed by depolymerization. In fact, we have confirmed this by using isotopic tracer techniques where we label the ethylene as opposed to the CO. And finally, What we find is that Ethel Marine Corporation is negligible for the lighter olefins, with the exception of Ethel. Becomes again significant for the higher molecular weight olefins, C9 and higher, because of the fizzy absorption that occurs. Now, the last thing I wanted to show you is concerning methanol decomposition and synthesis. I'll show it to you here. If you read the literature, what you find out from surface science and studies with supported catalysts is that methanol decomposition on copper has been studied extensively. What one observes, in addition to methanol, is evidence for methoxy species and formates. And in trying to explain how one goes from methanol to either formaldehyde or CO2 as the final products, various authors invoke the presence of adsorbed formaldehyde and a species which is called methylene oxy. It's a methylene group straddling two oxygens which are attached to the copper surface. But neither of these groups in the past have been observed under conditions of methanol decomposition. If one looks at the methanol synthesis literature, then there's a growing body of literature that suggests that the primary source of carbon for methanol is CO2 rather than CO, and that the way that CO becomes involved is through the water gas shift reaction. So let's see what we can learn about all of this if we start to do some temperature program studies. And the objectives here are to identify, if not all, at least most of the intermediates involved in methanol synthesis and decomposition, where possible, determine the dynamics of elementary processes, and see what we can say about things. The approach here is to combine transient response in the gas phase and also for lead spectroscopy. So what we're going to look at are some TPD, TPDIR, TPRIR combined technique kind of experiments. So here's an example of what one can see. We do an absorption from a 1% methanol, helium, or argon mixture on produced copper on silica. Then take a series of infrared spectra as one ramps the temperature while flushing the catalyst argon. There are peaks in the region of 29 wave numbers, which can be identified with adsorbed methanol, also with bidentate formate. Bidentate formate also shows up here in the low frequency range. And here, at about 1720 wave numbers, is a well-defined peak for formaldehyde, showing that, in fact, formaldehyde is present on the catalyst surface during methanol decomposition. Now, if a little oxygen has been put onto the catalyst surface beforehand, one can see some additional species, which are some of the other intermediates involved in methanol decomposition. So this is for a pre-oxidized catalyst. Here again are peaks associated with methanol, formate. Now one has over here a shoulder, which is identified with epoxy. Here's a band at 2700 and some wave numbers associated with the CH2 vibrations in this methylene disoxy. And its companion bending modes are located down here around 1400 wave numbers. In the low frequency range, now one sees peaks for monodentate formate. So again, one can see qualitatively, at least from these spectra, evidence for some of the intermediates that have been claimed for the decomposition of methanol. Now, as I say, we can parallel these experiments with an examination of the gas phase. And here, what we do is take a reduced catalyst, expose it again to 1% methanol, carrier, turn off the flow of methanol, ramp the temperature, and observe, of course, the desorption of methanol, a small amount of formaldehyde. Hydrogen comes off in two peaks, the first being associated with the transformation of methanol to formaldehyde, and the second accompanying the release of CO2. If you deconvolute these peaks and look at the ratio of hydrogen to CO2, it's in exactly the right proportions for the decomposition of formate. So in fact, what we're looking at here is the decomposition of formate groups to CO2 and hydrogen. And this, in fact, is the temperature range where we see by infrared spectroscopy that the formate groups are being decomposed. So with this kind of qualitative look at results, what we decided to do is to try and simulate what we have. So we took the scheme that is described in the literature for the methanol decomposition to CO2 and hydrogen. So reversible adsorption of methanol, loss of a hydrogen to make methoxy, loss of another hydrogen to make adsorbed formaldehyde, reversible adsorption of formaldehyde. Oxygen addition, either from oxygen intentionally put on the copper surface or possibly from hydroxyl groups associated with the silica, forms methylene disoxide species, which then sheds a hydrogen to make formate, which then decomposes ultimately in a multi-step process to produce CO2 and hydrogen. And what we have said is that steps 1, 2, 4, 5, and 7 are the ones which are dictating the overall kinetics of the process, and we have simulated the infrared results based on a scheme assigning appropriate growth rate coefficients where needed. And what comes out then are the enthalpy of adsorption over here, activation energy for this step, again, enthalpy of adsorption, activation energy for step number 5, and finally for step number 7. Let me show you on this next transparency the extent to which we can fit the experimental data. What I've plotted here are surface coverages that are deduced by quantitative analysis of the infrared spectrum. Now, I draw to your attention that these are small surface coverages. Notice the factor of 10 to the third here, multiplying theta. So these are coverages of less than 1%, in fact, they're a tenth of 1% of a monolith. Very small coverages requiring good signal to noise in the infrared in order to see these species. And so what we have here are the transients for the bidentate formate, the largest peak here, for the formaldehyde here, and for the adsorbed methanol here. So time zero sets where we begin, and then we go on, and the solid line is the best fit to these data, results then in these activation energies I showed earlier. Now, to have an independent test of how valid this model is, we've also calculated what we should see in the gas phase. This is the TPD spectrum. And here's the calculated TPD spectrum, which shows the evolution of methanol and formaldehyde concurrently, which is what we saw experimentally, and then at a higher temperature, the evolution of CO2. And if we wished, we could also plot out here the evolution concurrently of hydrogen. How good is this? Well, it's okay. It's not great. We're a little bit high on the temperature of CO2 evolution here, a little bit low on the evolution temperature for methanol and formaldehyde. Better than qualitatively, we capture most of the features that are seen experimentally in the TPD spectrum. And the experimental TPD spectrum was not used to obtain the rate parameters that were used in the model. Now, how do you pull all of this together, finally, to say something about methanol synthesis? We've done methanol synthesis also in the TPR IR mode at 7 atmospheres. We see virtually all of the same intermediates that we see during methanol decomposition. So we will claim that what happens during methanol synthesis is CO2 adsorption to make adsorbed CO2. This is a very weakly bound species. We believe that hydrogen attacks at one end of this molecule to make this kind of a probably very unstable intermediate that is associated with CO and OH. We can observe this end of the chemistry, the appearance of CO. This can I summarize to the formate group, which is the first intermediate one sees in the chain for its methanol. And after that, we have this, the methylene disoxy, formaldehyde, methoxy, and methanol coming up in the gas phase methanol. And nicely coupled to this is the water gas shift process, which is this upper line. Here is CO2, hydrogen, one is CO, water, and the reverse process. Now, what's very interesting is that if you start with CO2 and hydrogen, this line is operative, and you make methanol very rapidly. But 30 times more rapidly, you carry out the reverse water gas shift process. And the way you inhibit that reverse water gas shift process is to put CO into the feed. This is not an infinity sign. This is really CO. Just the default drawing scheme on my computer. So if you put in CO over here, you drive the reaction backwards by the forward water gas process and drive it down this line. And in fact, both thermodynamically and experimentally, that's exactly what you see. If you put in just CO and hydrogen over this catalyst, it's dead in the doornail. It doesn't make any methanol. In fact, it doesn't make any products. We're very careful to exclude the sodium, so we don't make any methane either. So it appears that CO2 is, in fact, the correct source of carbon for making methanol. CO gets into the act, but by coupling of this second catalytic cycle to the first. So the conclusions for this last segment are shown here. All of the carbon-containing intermediates involved in methanol decomposition can be observed by TPDIR. Most of them. Activation energies can be obtained for some of the elementary processes by simulation of the TPDIR spectrum. And then we show that in situ IR spectra taken during temperature program methanol synthesis show evidence for many of the same species seen during methanol decomposition, suggesting that the process by which methanol is formed and composed are identical, similar. So let me conclude here by giving thanks to the people who did this work. This is a rather international group. Mike DePontis is from South Africa, was a postdoc who worked with Grant Yokomizo, one of my Japanese-American students, on the first segment of the work looking at the spectrum of rate coefficients. Kamala Krishna from India, Takashi Komaya from Japan, worked together on the analysis of Fischer Tropsch kinetics. Dean Clark, who is a native son of Iowa, and Dong Kyun Lee, who is from Korea, worked together on the methanol synthesis and decomposition project. All this was supported by the Department of Energy. Thank you very much. Transparency back, and we'll give you a synopsis of that. So we have looked at that. Some of this is your own work, right? So, this number, the best we can find from the surface science literature, is 17 kilocalories per mole versus 14.5. I'll let you decide whether that's similar or not. This one, I don't recall whether it has been reported. Our number is 5.6. I'm not sure what the surface science literature says with that one. I don't know if it is really very small. Okay. This one is off. The surface science literature says 14. We say, call it 8. I'd call that a real difference. But if you look at the surface science literature, there are some assumptions that are made up front about the size of the pre-exponential factor. It's assumed to be 10 to the 13th without any discussion as to why that should be. And then it's a the number comes out of an analysis of a TPD curve. So if you will allow a different pre-exponential factor, you'll get a different number here. This one, as far as I know, has not been observed. And this one, you report in an old paper, 29 kilocalories. We call it 19. And there's a real horse race there.
29 versus 19?
Yeah.
Oh,
Huh?
About 20.
Is it about 20?
Yes.
Okay, then that must be more recent than number.
Well, that's definitely around 20, yes.
Yeah, well, then it's close. That's great.
Yeah, 20 or something.
Yeah.
On the same side, there's a discrepancy set 3, which you don't believe to be any legitimate thing to significant. Both the surface science literature and the Dallas literature has the apparent activation, which is about 24 calories per mole.
For step
3.
Well, we say it's not significant because this, you don't see much of this on the surface during the reaction. We think this process is very rapid. Now, it doesn't matter really what you can take it however you like. If this is irreversible and we're at a pseudo steady state, so we're not building up the species, we're building it down, then this rate equals that one. That's what we've done essentially.
Yeah.
And because this is very small, that's why we can say we can invoke the pseudo steady state hypothesis.
That's one last comment.
This will take me off. We learned that if you could see it by infrared on the catalyst, it wasn't viable mechanism. That's obviously correct.
Well, that's like saying what you can't see can't hurt you, Paul. I think as techniques get better and one works harder to look at these things at lower and lower concentration levels, eventually you will see them at the level where they do mean something.
There's a trick too. If you're ramping the temperature, you're seeing them form and then disappear.
That's right.
You move through a time domain where they exist.
Right.
You try to do this at a steady state temperature, 600 Kelvin or whatever.
Yeah.
You wouldn't see anything.
Well, we've done this at steady state also during methanol synthesis, and even at 7 atmospheres, where you try to push everything, the pressure would be favorable, and you're really making methanol. Your surface coverages now are in the 10^-4 of a monolayer, thereabouts. They don't even get up this high. We've kind of jacked things up by introducing methanol potential in the gas phase. But the fact that the dynamics here in the gas phase and the surface phase correlate is, I think, the most significant qualitative bit of information that says that there is a relationship between what you see on the surface and what goes on.
Yeah, I wasn't arguing with that. I just wanted to point out that things must have changed.
Well, I think techniques
have 50 years.
Yeah. Techniques have improved, and this is just like looking for pollutants in the atmosphere. Years before we couldn't see them, now we know they're there. Trace them, worry about them.